My name is Dr. James Jaggers. I am a professor of pediatric cardiac surgery at the University of Colorado and at Children's Hospital Colorado. I'm also the co-director of the Heart Institute here at Children's Hospital Colorado. I'm going to take the opportunity today to talk to you about a complex heart defect that we oftentimes deal with here at Children's. It's an area of specialty that we've developed over the last few years. Hypoplastic left heart syndrome is a heart defect that results in poor development or hypoplasia of the left side of the heart structures. It represents about 3 out of every 10,000 live births, and it also represents about 3% of all the heart defects we have to deal with. In this heart defect, the left heart structures didn't develop normally. So the mitral valve, the aortic valve, the left ventricle, and the aorta themselves are hypoplastic, so that the left ventricle cannot function as a systemic ventricle. This results in essentially obstruction of blood flow to the body in development and after birth. The only way for the baby to maintain a cardiac output after birth is to maintain a patent ductus arteriosus. This requires prostaglandin therapies shortly after birth. Untreated, the mortality rate is nearly 100% in the first few weeks of life. Prenatal diagnosis is essential for this particular heart defect, as it's very important that therapy is initiated right after birth. This defect can usually be visualized very early on in pregnancy and is oftentimes seen by a screening ultrasound by the obstetrician. That usually generates a referral to a maternal fetal medicine specialist and a fetal cardiologist. It's really important to make this diagnosis as early as you can, as some parents may actually choose to terminate a pregnancy for this heart defect. It's also important to understand the genetics of the baby and any other coexisting congenital anomalies. Some of these anomalies and some of these genetics do make long-term survival very difficult, and therapy may not be indicated. It also allows us to properly plan for delivery. Because these children can become very sick after delivery, it's important that mothers deliver at a center where the baby is ultimately going to be taken care of. Here at Children's Hospital, we've actually dedicated an entire floor to our maternal fetal medicine unit and our fetal care center. In this case, moms can deliver here on our maternal fetal medicine ward, and babies can be transported immediately down to the cardiac intensive care unit where they can get their care. It also allows us the opportunity to plan any emergent procedures that might be necessary. In some situations, fetal diagnosis can result in a fetal intervention. There are essentially two different types of intervention that may be useful in some children with hypoplastic left heart syndrome. One of those is a balloon aortic valvotomy in children with critical aortic stenosis. Left untreated in the fetus, this will result in some cases in hypoplastic left heart syndrome. In the other case is children with restrictive or obstructed pulmonary venous return by an intact atrial septum. In these children, if a fetal intervention is performed to open up that septum, children can survive and even sometimes can develop that left ventricle. However, if not treated, then those babies can be delivered and can become exceedingly sick right after surgery, as there'll be no systemic cardiac output. Once the baby is born, after the baby says hi to the mom for a few minutes, we'll go down to the cardiac intensive care unit where therapy can be initiated. Prostaglandin therapy is very necessary in order to keep the ductus arteriosus open, as that's the only source of systemic blood flow. It'll also allow the opportunity to do an echocardiogram on the baby itself to make sure we see all the structures and to see and understand the physiology. It's important to note during delivery that we have the opportunity here at Children's Hospital to harvest cord blood and store that. We're involved in a consortium along with 5 other centers called the Hypoplastic Left Heart Syndrome Consortium. As part of the research associated with this consortium, we will harvest cord blood for these patients and we'll store it. And later on, that cord blood can be used to generate stem cells that can be injected into the heart at the second stage surgery. And that can actually improve the function of the heart long term. This is a very unique opportunity and a unique type of research that we're doing here at Children's along with the Mayo Clinic. Once the baby has recovered from the delivery and all the diagnostic procedures are performed, a surgical strategy will be planned. We try to individualize therapy for all babies with this type of heart defect. There's essentially three different options for therapy. One is called the Norwood procedure, the other would be cardiac transplantation, and the third one would be what we call a hybrid Norwood procedure. We traditionally, up until about the last 10 years or so, had been doing cardiac transplantation for this heart defect with excellent outcomes. It is a good option for this type of heart defect. Unfortunately, the donor pool is such that it's very difficult to get donor hearts for babies with this heart defect. We have moved to a more palliative approach for this heart defect, and that includes the Norwood procedure. This operation was developed by Bill Norwood and is currently the most favored therapy for this heart defect. This strategy involves a series of three operations, the first one being in the first week or so of life, the second one being at approximately 4 to 6 months of life, and then the final one approximately 2 to 4 years of age. The Norwood procedure really accomplishes three things. One is we have to create an unobstructed blood flow to the body by reconstructing the aorta. To do this, we use the pulmonary valve and replace the pulmonary circulation with a arterial circulation. In order to do this, we have to patch the aorta and enlarge it. We connect the newly reconstructed aorta to the pulmonary artery and pulmonary valve, and that provides an unobstructed blood flow to the body. We also have to remove the septum, or the wall, between the right and the left atrium. This is called an atrial septectomy. That allows the blood from the body returning and the blood from the lungs returning to mix, to go into the ventricle so that it can be pumped out to the body. Finally, we have to provide blood flow to the lungs. In order to provide blood flow to the lungs, we create a shunt. This is a tube sewn to the right ventricle that goes to the pulmonary artery, or it's a tube that goes from the innominate artery down to the pulmonary artery. This allows for pulmonary blood flow in this period of time between the first and the second stage surgery. This operation is relatively straightforward, but does carry some risk. The outcomes for this operation have improved dramatically over the last 25 years. The mortality rate for this operation used to be approximately 50% 25 years ago. Currently, the mortality rate in our center is approximately 10%. Across the country, our outcomes are slightly better than this, as there is a mortality rate across the country averaging about 15 to 16%. Children need to spend a fair bit of time in the hospital after the surgery. There are many things that can happen and many complications that can occur. But in general, after about a month or so, children are discharged to home. It's important to remember that complications can also occur while children are at home. That's why we follow these children very carefully with our complex congenital clinic. This consists of a team of people, including pediatric cardiologists, cardiac surgeons, nutritionists, and psychologists. Problems that can occur in the interstage period can result in mortality. In fact, the mortality rate in the interstage period is approximately 5 to 10%. Currently, our mortality rate in the interstage period is approximately 3%. The second stage surgery usually occurs about 4 to 6 months of age. The impetus to do the second stage surgery is usually because children are outgrowing their shunt and they have inadequate pulmonary blood flow. During this operation, we disarticulate or remove the superior vena cava from the right atrium, and we sew it directly onto the pulmonary artery. This allows for pulmonary blood flow to be by a passive venous drainage directly to the lungs. Now, half of the venous drainage is still going back to the heart, so the oxygen saturations after the surgery are still going to be around 75 to 85%. But this is a more stable source of pulmonary blood flow, and children generally are much less likely to have complications following this surgery. The long-term outcome associated with this type of palliation is sometimes dependent on myocardial function. So as I mentioned before, we're part of the Hypoplastic Left Heart Syndrome Consortium, and one of the research projects associated with this is actually taking that fetal cord blood and developing stem cells from that cord blood and re-injecting them into the myocardium at the second stage surgery. Our hope is that this will result in improved myocardial function over the long haul. In fact, in early experiments, we have seen that the myocardial function is significantly improved after injection of stem cells at 2 or 3 months after the second stage surgery. So we're involved in this study along with other centers across the country, and hopefully we'll be able to report these results soon. The final surgery is the Fontan procedure. The Fontan procedure is generally performed between 2 and 4 years of age. This operation, we take the inferior vena cava from the heart, we sew a tube onto this inferior vena cava, and we extend that up to the pulmonary artery. This allows all the systemic venous return to passively drain into the lungs. So oxygen saturations are substantially increased into the mid-90s following this surgery. It's important to know that long-term, this type of physiology can result in complications, and we do know that the myocardium of the right ventricle is not intended to be a systemic pumping chamber. So there is some risk long-term that this ventricle will fail. And in fact, some children and young adults will need transplant with this heart defect. We've recognized these complications here at Children's, and we have paid special attention by creating a new Fontan clinic that we've initiated approximately 2 years ago. This is a multi-specialty clinic in which patients with Fontan physiology can come and have all of their problems addressed. It consists of a team of cardiologists, adult congenital cardiologists, as we know that these children will grow up into adults and have adult problems, pulmonologists, gastroenterologists, nutritionists, exercise physiologists, and psychologists. The long-term complications associated with the Fontan physiology can be life-threatening. These can include development of liver problems, including cirrhosis, gastrointestinal problems, including protein-losing enteropathy, and they can also develop long-term depression and neurologic problems as well. It's important that these children maintain exercise because exercise has been shown to improve long-term outcome and cardiac function. Some children will develop cardiac failure. This could be associated with atrial ventricular valve insufficiency, and children sometimes do need additional operations. But ultimately, if the myocardium fails, then a transplant's the only therapy. One of the things that's associated with these heart defect repairs is the use of patch material. Whenever we use a patch to reconstruct the heart, like the aorta, that patch will not grow. It's made out of prosthetic material, and you can form scar with this patch, and it essentially becomes a restrictor. One of the important pieces of research we're performing here at Children's is in collaboration with the bioengineering department. We're trying to develop patch material that is actually made of a patient's own tissue. So we've created a scaffold in which we can seed with stem cells, and this will reconstruct or recreate the normal architecture of either aorta, pulmonary artery, or even myocardium. This is in collaboration with one of our bioengineers, Jeff Jaco. He's developed a very unique process to seed stem cells into a patch material, and we can actually create beating myocardial patch. Ultimately, we hope to be able to use this patch material either in the aorta or on the heart that will grow with the patient and function like it should normally function.